lecture series. My name is Sarah Riff. I'm the Outreach Coordinator and Undergrad Advisor for the Latin American, Caribbean, and Iberian Studies program, and I'm really pleased to see all you guys here today and happy to be back. I've actually been out on leave since November, so I'm back. Looking forward to being here for the lecture series every week myself. So obviously you saw we've got some food and drinks in the back. Please help yourself. It's from a local restaurant here in Madison, and they are authentic El Salvadorian pupusas. So I just wanted to mention that in the back corner there's a sign-in sheet if you're interested in being added to our email listserv if you're not already on it. And that's about all I have, so I'll turn it over to our students and faculty who are here today to talk about the El Salvador class. Thanks.
I guess we'll start off with introductions. My name is Lauren Dana.
I'm Nick Nelson.
And I'm Valeria Serna.
And we're all part of the Salvadoran course, Classes 440, El Salvador Land and People. And this winter break, we went to El Salvador in a delegation.
Sure. So I'm one of the instructors in the course, and I thought I'd give you a little bit of a background on this course because it's kind of unusual. It's kind of unique, maybe. That it's a collaborative effort on the part of both UW and Edgewood College. The course has been taught for quite a few years at Edgewood, dating back to 1997, and the course is offered every other year, and it involves it's a year-long course, which itself during the course of the year, there's a trip to El Salvador, and roughly 2 weeks, a little less than 2 weeks. So my name is Patrick Barrett. I'm administrative director of the Haven Center, and I also teach in Las Heas. And a few years ago, I, like many other people over the years, went on the delegation, the trip to El Salvador, just as a member of the community who happened to have been invited by the two people who teach the course at Edgewood, namely Ian Davis and Mark Rosenthal. And I was so impressed by the program that I immediately started thinking about how we can make this available for UW students who develop a collaborative relationship. And the first person I spoke to after returning to Madison was Alberto. And he felt the same way. He was familiar with the course. So we've now taught, this is the second year that we teach the course as a joint effort. And so Nick, for example, is an Edgewood student, and Lauren and Valeria are UW students. And we now do the course. It used to be the case trip was over spring break. But the spring breaks, whereas in the past they coincided for the two schools, they no longer do, so now we do it over winter break. And the course aims at giving a background in the history of the country, but using it as a way of providing a window into much larger issues that go beyond these specific experiences of El Salvador, whether that's U.S. foreign policy or the economic development of the region, the history of the region, social movements, a whole variety of different issues that El Salvador serves as an example of. So I'm going to turn it back over to you guys.
All right, so the plan is to keep it light. If you guys have any questions about our experiences, just raise your hand or just shout it out, ask your question. Yeah, so the question is, so what do we all do there anyhow? So this will be documenting our two-week delegation to the country. Starting off, we had an early morning start. I mean, to be exact. Around in the airport. And after a few delayed flights, we finally arrived in San Salvador.
How did you get there?
How did we get there? We flew. So we flew.
Yeah, sure, but I mean, that's exactly the thing. How?
Where was our?
From Madison to where?
No, we flew out of Chicago and O'Hare, so we had to get down there. And then we flew to Miami, and then from Miami to San Salvador.
Okay.
How many hours were we delayed?
It was a while.
So on the way back, you couldn't take that train?
No, we took the same route back. We went from San Salvador to Miami to Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And the flight flight out of Chicago was at 5:30 in the morning.
Yep.
Yeah. So we had a.
So how did you get there?
We, yeah.
Every person did their own thing.
We huddled right next to the Starbucks and just waited until 5:30 in the morning.
So 5:30 in O'Hare. When did you leave here in Madison?
I left. I actually took a bus. I think around midnight. I arrived in Chicago at midnight, and then we had to wait 5.5 hours.
But you left Madison then before midnight.
Yeah. So we left around like 9, actually.
So 36 hours without bed.
Yeah.
It was a long trip.
Here's a little bit of the airport customs immigration. First sights of El Salvador right after leaving the airport.
What was interesting about that when they arrived was I arrived before the group got there. I got there about 5 days before.
5 days?
Yeah, so I decided to do some sightseeing with a couple of friends that are from El Salvador. But that specific day, there was protests where they closed off all the streets heading into the city. So when I found out, maybe about 8 in the morning in Salvador, that all the streets were closed, nothing was getting into the city, I didn't know if they were going to be able to get in. Just because there was like a lot of, I know it was veterans who were protesting benefits. So they managed to close off all the streets going into the city. And I had no way of contacting them because my phone service doesn't reach in that country. So I just kind of had to wait it out and see if they would arrive. And they did arrive late, but they got there and I was a little worried, thinking that they weren't going to break up the protests by then. But they somehow managed, and just from word of mouth, people would tell me that was probably one of the biggest protests they had in a while. That was like able to close off all the streets going into San Salvador. So it's interesting. And I also have the newspapers from the following day, and it's very different how they all frame the protest.
It's very hot, but you can feel probably 90 degrees.
Yeah.
I take that any day nowadays.
Yeah. Here's a picture of the outside of our hostel. We got there, it's dark already. Casa Lito, Casa de la Amistad. So the first day we were there, one of the first things we did was we visited the church where Archbishop Oscar Romero was assassinated. So this is the altar where he was assassinated. It's inside the church. So this says, on this altar, Oscar Romero offered up his life to God for his people. And here's the little house where he lived, just not far from the church where he died. 50 feet? No.
100? Yeah. It's a very modest house. There's very, very few things in there. But it just reflects just the simplicity of his life that he wanted.
It's
preserved,
like.
Yes, after he was murdered, I think there was a group of nuns or a couple of people that wanted to preserve his like house. So what they did is they took all of the clothes. You actually can go in there and see the clothes that he was, like the robes that he was wearing when he was assassinated, and a lot of all of his like artifacts, like all of his beds, books, his linings for the bed are still there. His toothbrush is still there. Like, it preserves everything. And it's really, really cool.
I don't know if you guys remember this, but our guide told us this story about this group from China that came and visited the house, and they just, like, immediately started crying when they got there. It was really impactful to me to just see how far-reaching Romero's words traveled.
By the way, this is Claire.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry, I'm Claire.
She
also
went on the trip.
Later that day, we visited the memorial wall in the middle of San Salvador. As you can see, it looks very similar to our own memorial at the Vietnam War. Just this long list of names and places where people were massacred.
Massacred cities or little pueblos that were massacred, people's names that were gone, and just kidnappings, just the list goes on and on.
This is during the Civil War.
Yes.
Sorry.
It ended in 1950.
Yeah. See how many casualties took in the 12 years of the...
It was like two portions of the wall. That was like the first portion, I think it said like 25,000 names, I think, if I'm not mistaken. But I know for sure that the end part, it was like in a separate addition, and that was about an additional 3,000 names. So since that part, they haven't added yet, but I'm pretty sure they're going to add more.
The estimates are about 75,000 people with COVID. So this is just a portion.
So then we met with members from NPR 12.
It's the Popular Revolution.
Yeah.
So one of the reasons that this is such a powerful experience is that we are relying on two networks, well-established historical networks. One is the U.S. El Salvador Sister City Network, of which the Madison Arquetao Sister City Project is the longest-lived standing. It's over 25 years old at this point. And they, in turn, have a relationship with this network of umbrella group of social movement organizations whose acronym is CREPIT. And this is something that grew out of the Civil War. And then it evolved into an organization that dealt with a variety of different ways in which people were dealing with the aftermath of the war and development and other types of things, including whatever type of social issue that you can imagine, whether health or agriculture, all sorts of things. So that network makes possible this set of relationships and the opportunity to meet with all these types of organizations.
And as you can see here, actually one of our students is introducing our group as well. That was one of the things we always had to do. We took turns, one person to introduce our group, tell a little bit about where we're from, why we're there, and then at the end, of course, a different person typically would thank them.
And we would go around throughout El Salvador talking with all these groups, and they were focused around, because we went down there as four groups, we were split off as like 15 people, we split off into four groups. One was environmental community development, one was health, another one was health and, I think, women.
One was women organizations, education, historical memory, and environment.
Yeah. So.
Here is our entire delegation members from here.
Better get a group.
The next day, we actually participated in a workshop with youth leaders from NPR 12. They had us do some interesting activities. This specific one was geared towards the end goal?
You had to achieve all these like objects without breaking some bond, like with the ropes.
Yeah.
<Yeah. laughs>
Later that day, we visited the Museo de la Palabra y la Imagen, Museum of the Word and Image. So this is a relatively new museum. Inside are all the multimedia and different things from the war. This room, I think, is specifically dedicated to immigration and the routes that people had to go through to get to different countries, to escape the country. And this is a point in time which Alberto joined us. The link.
Can
I say a little bit about...
Absolutely.
So the other thing, see that gentleman in the blue shirt and the white hair in the very back? His nom de guerre is Santiago. I always forget his real name. But he's a Venezuelan journalist who came to El Salvador shortly after the beginning of the Civil War and established this clandestine radio called Radio Ensayos. And it was one of two that was very important. Both of these radios moved around and often hid in caves, and they would set up and they would basically try to get the word out about what was actually happening on the ground, the experience of people directly at the war. And it was a hugely important source of information. good example of an effort to preserve historical memory is Bickford. We have all sorts of programs in which we go around the country trying to educate, especially student groups and others about their own history.
And then I thought it was really, I like this museum because it, one, preserves the historical memory of all of El Salvador, like famous, I mean, there was a poet, I forgot what his name was, in the back there. But it also puts like El Salvador in a worldly perspective for today because they have the immigration, like we're all, a lot of El Salvadorans or Salvadorans are today because they send remittances back. That's a large part of their economy. And there's actually, the coolest part about this museum, in my opinion, was there was a huge wall that had like, what is your dream? Or what is your like Salvadoran dream? And then it was just filled with like little notes from like Salvadoran youth about what they want to do in their life. I thought that was really cool.
And then in the lower, to your left, Estela is the person works for the Sister Cities Network in El Salvador. She's very enthusiastic, and she's the daughter of a Mexican activist who went to El Salvador in the time of the war and stayed there. So now her daughter is involved in the movement too.
So is she the liaison for the U.S. El Salvador Sister Cities?
As you talk about migration, something I found as I was there in November last year, which was something bizarre, among the many bizarre things that I found, they told me, all right, there are about 3 million Salvador people that emigrated to the United States. And in the meantime, there are people from Honduras who come to immigrate into El Salvador to earn dollars. And it's just too bizarre for me to understand. But there's, of course, nothing more bizarre than reality. That's why people want to ever read fiction.
A lot of El Salvador today is taking in a lot of Honduran refugees because because of the war, the conflict that's coming up.
The next group we met with was Equipo Mice.
Equipo Mice.
They spoke to us a lot about agricultural issues, trading, how that's affecting the economy.
It's a popular education.
Yeah.
And this is probably one of the most rewarding parts of our delegation, was we had the chance to meet Maria. She fought during the war. Today she is, I mean, she's still working for rights, for Salvadoran rights. And she's just an extremely powerful woman. Her smile, her personality is just incredible. Fills up the room.
She was very integral in the like Salvadoran Civil War, and even today now she's become a politician because there's two parties. There's the, I would say, the right Arena Party, and then there's the FMLN, which is more on the left side. And she was originally, like during the war, it was the FMLN that came together that was, I guess, the guerrilla movement, and when the peace accords were signed, they were signed into as an actual party, and she plays a very key role now in politics in El Salvador.
She's a government minister.
Yeah.
And she was a guerrilla fighter during the war. Yeah.
The next day we left San Salvador to Guarquiva, and this is a small village that we stopped in on our way to Arquetao, which is the sister city of Madison. While there, we had the opportunity to speak on the radio for Radio San Pool.
And the river, like the San Pool River, runs from, like, I think it's from, from upwards down into El Salvador, and it's a very integral water source for the country. So,
a word about this radio station. It's a community radio station. They are another one of them, which is really famous because it's at the forefront. We didn't get a chance to visit it. Is Radio Victoria, which is a sister radio station with WORT, which also has a long history and a fascinating history, but a very long standing operation.
Do you have time to next day, we finally arrived in Arkansas, which, like you have heard us mention, is the sister city to UW-Madison from the Sister Cities Network. And right away, we met with members of the town council and presented them with certain gifts.
Well, okay, they were gifts, but they were actually drawings from the Civil War when the man on the left, Mark Rosenthal, went down there. All these kids would draw these little just drawings of just how their day is, how their life is. And a lot of them depicted a lot of stuff related to the war, like guns, a lot of children dead, a lot of people dead. And it was very stark to see them for the first time. Even then, seeing them now, they were incredibly profound. And he also presented, a mortar that was found in the mountains? And I think it's, right here. And when they were going up to, I think the mountain's called La Cabana, or Cañada. They found it up there, and it was brought back to Madison, and I think Madison, a politician, saw it, or showed it to him, and then he went on to the fight and went down to El Salvador and saw everything. And then they just brought it back to the museum, the local museum that's there.
I mean, part of it was a lot of these people, they saw these pictures again, and I think it was really powerful for them to see them, drawings that they had done when they were little, that they maybe didn't even remember, to all of a sudden be returned to their hands years later.
And it was really interesting that the people that we were being, they were letting us stay at their homes, a lot of them had a lot of stories about what had happened during the war and explained their trip to Honduras and when they came back and how they were rebuilding their home. And a lot of the homes that we stayed in were the homes that were being built as soon as they got back. So they just kind of, with my host mother, she talked about the different parts of the house that they built first and what was the most important and how what their work experience was before they left and after they left, and just the things that they seen. It was a really overwhelming amount of information that we got in less than 24 hours.
I know my host dad was a guerrilla fighter for 12 years for the entire duration of the war, which is almost unheard of to survive that. And then my host mother had left Arkansas for, I think, over 10 years, but it was still important to them to bring their family back to the community and raise them there.
Where was she?
I don't remember where she went. Possibly San Salvador.
And my mother, at that point during the Civil War, there was no health institutions. So they mended their own wounds and everything. And my mother, my host mom, was the health administrator of the community. And it was really cool because we did another trip. I think it was the ecological trip.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Here are just some pictures.
What was her name, your mother?
I can't recall. I remember my brothers. They were Jamelos, they were twins. But I think she was named...
Was it Luz?
It was...
No,
I didn't say it was Luz. I think it was maybe...
Okay.
So here are just some pictures of Arkansas. Here's the town square, the church, inside the church. So this was we took a hike up into the La Cañada, which is the mountain that resides right next to Arkansas. This is where people would hide during the war. And our guide, Nico, actually he guided us through and up to La Cañada, tell us stories along the way. So this you can see here is a tattoo. It's a hole carved into the side of the mountain where people would hide during the war. You can't tell from this picture, but about a minute after this was taken, the kids were inside and a whole bunch of bats came flying out and scared everyone. But happened about a minute after this picture was taken.
So they would hide in there because they would, the mountainside was being bombarded by air.
Yes.
By the Salvador.
So once we finally reached the top, we had a nice lunch with the locals who accompanied us on our hike. Ate some pupusas. We also visited the schools in Arkansas and spoke with the vice principal, was it?
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about their mission. This is the high school. That's interesting.
Yeah. What we felt that was like really important about this was that we don't even see these like type of murals like on the walls in our own schools, and it was just very interesting that it's promoting, you know, safe sex, and not only that, but like interracial relationships, where in our own societies you really don't see that promotion, even though the school is really based in Christian social teaching, there is still that promotion of safe sex and interreligious relationships. And I thought it was really interesting to see that, considering that people sometimes would like to call.
Lunchtime lecture series. My name is Sarah Rith. I'm the outreach coordinator and undergrad advisor for the Latin American, Caribbean, and Iberian Studies program. And I'm really pleased to see all you guys here today and happy to be back. I've actually been out on leave since November, so this is, I'm back. Looking forward to being here for the lecture series every week myself. So obviously you saw we've got some food and drinks in the back. Please help yourself. It's from a local restaurant here in Madison, and they are authentic El Salvadorian pupusas. So I just wanted to mention that in the back corner there's a sign-in sheet if you're interested in being added to our email listserv if you're not already on it. And that's about all I have, so I'll turn it over to our students and faculty who are here today to talk about the El Salvador class. Thanks.
I guess we'll start off with introductions. My name is Lauren Dana.
I'm Nick Nelson.
And I'm Valeria Cerda.
And we're all part of the Salvadoran course, Classes 440, El Salvador Land and People. And this winter break, we went to El Salvador in a delegation.
Sure. So I'm one of the instructors in the course, and I thought I'd give you a little bit of a background on this course because it's kind of unusual. It's kind of unique, maybe. That it's a collaborative effort on the part of both UW and Edgewood College. The course has been taught for quite a few years at Edgewood, dating back to 1997, and the course is offered every other year, and it involves, it's a year-long course, which itself during the course of the year, there's a trip to El Salvador, and roughly 2 weeks, a little less than 2 weeks. So my name is Patrick Barrett. I'm administrative director of the Haven Center, and I also teach in Las Vegas. And a few years ago, I, like many other people over the years, went on the delegation, the trip to El Salvador, just as a member of the community who happened to have been invited by the two people who teach the course at Edgewood, namely Ian Davis do it over winter break. And the course aims at giving a background in the history of the country, but using it as a way of providing a window into much larger issues that go beyond these specific experiences of El Salvador, whether that's U.S. foreign policy or the economic development of the region and the history of the region, social movements, whole variety of different issues that El Salvador serves as an example. So I'm going to turn it back over to you guys because that's pretty much a good enough overview of history for the Rosenthal. And I was so impressed by the program that I make this available for UW students to develop a collaborative relationship. And the first person I spoke to after returning to Madison was Alberto. And he felt the same way. He was familiar with the course. So we've now taught, this is the second year that we teach the course as a joint effort. And so Nick, for example, is an Edgewood student, and Lauren and Valeria are UW students. And we now do the course, it used to be the case, trip was over spring break. But the spring breaks, whereas in the past they coincided for the two schools, they no longer do, so now we